You are in big trouble.
Have any of your neighborhood fast food restaurants recently shut its doors for good? Why are restaurant franchises closing so many locations? Could your favorite be next on the chopping block? Well, here are 14 fast food chains that are in devastating trouble now, and some will definitely surprise you.
We're in trouble! I'm in trouble!
TGI Fridays.
Friday were closed.
It's hard to believe a place known for the phrase, "Thank God it's Friday," would wind up saying, "Thank God we're still in business." We all know the feeling of finally leaving work on a Friday and heading out to our favorite food and beverage spot, but soon some of us will have a few less TGI Fridays locations to stop at. Billed by the company as the world's first casual bar and grill, the original TGI Fridays location opened in 1965 in New York City and was filled with 1890s-style decor and plenty of mingling singles in the age before fast casual cocktail and dining bars were commonplace. Through classic pub food and traditional cocktails, TGI's went on to expand from its New York roots into an international phenomenon, taking its iconic red and white stripes on a trip across the globe. The chain expanded to more than 650 restaurants across 51 nations, but the restaurant that was spawned in the swinging 60s has stumbled on tough times in the 21st century.
They think it's the 60s, man.
Nearly a dozen locations in New Jersey were busted for selling cheap alcohol at the price of the top shelf stuff in 2013, and 5 years later in 2018, the UK waitstaff went on strike because they couldn't get a raise. In the fall of 2023, the parent company overseeing TGI's Brazilian locations went bankrupt and started announcing location closures. But as soon as the calendar turned to 2024, these years of tribulations and troubles came to roost closer to home. In January of 2024, TGI Fridays shocked the industry with the announcement that they were suddenly closing 36 restaurants nationwide. This dropped the total American location count to around 230 from around 270, a number which had already been plummeting from nearly 300 restaurants just a few years earlier. The company has cited recent underperforming sales numbers as the reason for the closures, but for a chain that's been around for a long time, these cuts also seem to have been a long time coming.
Because we're out of money.
Subway.
It wasn't just Subway sandwiches that made me thin.
At one time, the superstar of the submarine sandwich, Subway could also once be considered the king of all fast food, although that crown has been slipping for quite some time. At the turn of the century in the year 2000, Subway's image as a restaurant that was as fast food but better for your health helped the brand expand to over 16,000 locations across the world. A decade and a half later, in 2015, Subway had 27,000 locations in the USA and 18,000 more worldwide. 6 years later, by the summer of 2021, that number had ballooned to more than 37,000 worldwide locations that were spread out across more than 100 countries. However, the drastic increase in restaurant numbers saw a drop in both quality and customer service, and things took a turn for the worse.
It's a little too much to handle.
The overall downturn in the decade between 2013 and 2023 is staggering. Stores have been shuttering at an alarming rate, sending sandwich artists packing after the close of more than 4,000 locations across the USA between 2018 and 2022. Subway still has more than 20,000 stores across the country, but the location closures suggest that the company might have both diluted its product and flooded its market. Menu revamps and new marketing has come in recent years, but even a July 2021 contest to give away free subs wound up being a foot-long flop. And it seems the market for the once mighty cold cut combo has officially frozen up.
Cold! So cold!
Quiznos.
What is a Quiznos?
After opening its first shop in 1981, Quiznos has been bringing tasty toasted sandwiches to the table. By 2005, Quiznos and its quirky singing monkey puppet mascots were up to 4,000 nationwide locations, spurred by its toastiness and the popularity of its self-serve pepper bar. Just 2 years later, in 2007, they were up by another 1,000 franchises to 5,000 locations, and company sales that year crushed calculators and cash registers by raking in $1.9 billion. But what goes up must come down, and while Subway was finally on the toasting train, new competition like Jersey Mike's and Jimmy John's had entered the national marketplace, and suddenly the signature toasted crunch was no longer a Quiznos exclusive. In fact, some places were doing it better.
Your toast, I know.
It seems success had gone to Quiznos' head, and that huge and sudden increase in locations meant drop-offs in other parts of business, including sales, forcing the company to officially declare bankruptcy in 2014. By the summer of 2021, Quiznos' numbers had collapsed from that 2007 peak of 5,000 coast-to-coast locations to a mere 250, which itself was down by more than half of the 800 they'd been cut to in 2019. Overall, it was almost a complete demise for the company, with 95% of its stores being closed by 2023. Only some 150 Quiznos were left standing at that point, and after years of toasting subs, it might be Quiznos itself that is officially toast.
You burnt.
Blimpie.
They pick fights and they pick Blimpies.
From paper bags at recess to lunch boxes at workplaces, the sandwich was once a mainstay of American life. But we've got one more struggling sandwich site that continues to make the case for the downfall of the once dominant delight. Named by its founders after the iconic image of a blimp that resembled the look of their restaurant sandwiches, Blimpie kicked open the door for the high-speed hoagie market when they first opened in 1964. Since Subway wouldn't arrive until 1 year later and Quiznos wouldn't show up until the 1980s, Blimpie was clear to fly to great heights in the 1970s and 1980s. Blimpie might be best known for how they opened a lot of new fast food avenues that would eventually become industry standard, like having locations and shopping malls, but the deliciousness started to deflate as the years wore on.
Something's wrong with my sandwich.
By 1995, Blimpie was selling its helium-inspired hoagies from over 1,000 nationwide locations and had even opened its first international outlet in Sweden. However, as the sandwich market started getting crowded, Blimpie floated back down to earth. Once peaking at over 2,000 franchises in 2011, Blimpie was down to less than 800 sandwich shops, and 500 of those closed in the years following the brand being sold to a new parent company in 2012. When the spring of 2021 rolled around, less than 130 Blimpies were still afloat, and it might not be much longer until this blimp deflates for good.
Buy a Jimmy John's franchise, maybe a Blimpies.
Boston Market.
You all laughed when I suggested Boston Market.
Originally specializing in rotisserie chickens and side dishes, Boston Market debuted as Boston Chicken when it was founded in a Boston suburb in the mid-80s. By 1995, the company had expanded its footprint and its menu, adding turkey, ham, and meatloaf to its chicken rotation and officially changing the restaurant name to Boston Market. Bringing the home-style touch into the fast-casual world, Boston Market has unfortunately become a victim of its own strategy. These days, you can find fresh and convenient rotisserie chicken not just at restaurants, but even at supermarkets. Walmart, Safeway, Whole Foods, Costco, and Sam's Club are just a few of the spots where you can get a comparable chicken at a cheaper price. And it has spelled disaster for Boston Market. In its 1990s prime, Boston Market had more than 1,000 locations across 28 states, growing from a humble count of almost three dozen locations in 1991.
You wanna go to Boston Market?
But increasing their franchise count by almost 4,000% so quickly came at a price, and the company was forced to declare bankruptcy in 1998. The brand was sold to multiple owners in the years since, including having a majority stake purchased by McDonald's in the year 2000, before that was sold off to another company in 2007, and those owners passed it on to yet a third in 2020. This uncertainty at the corporate level didn't help the chain, and both of the sales numbers and store count have been on a steady decline. By 2018, Boston Market outlets had dropped from its 1990s peak of more than 1,200 to just over 450.
There's not a Boston Market at the corner of Clyburn and North.
The snowball then kept rolling downhill, with just over 330 units left standing when 2021 came around, and the loss of another 30, leaving them with just 300 a year later in 2022. Just 1 year later after that, things got worse, with all Boston Market locations in the Detroit area permanently closing their doors due to unpaid rent in November of 2023. Less than a week later, 9 locations in Connecticut were shut down and evicted for the exact same offense. If those trends continue, it looks like Boston Market might get evicted from the marketplace completely.
That's someone's Boston Market that fell on the floor.
Before we reveal more, if it's your first time here, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Now, more franchises that are sending distress signals. Krystal.
And let me get a 5 cheese Krystal combo, no fries.
Even though Krystal's the oldest fast food chain in the southeastern USA and has been slinging sliders for almost a century, it's seen and continues to see its share of hard times. The restaurants aren't a household national name due to Krystal locations being concentrated in the South and in less than a dozen states, so they simply don't have the widespread reach that some competitors do. The first Krystal was founded in 1932, and like many establishments of the time, piggybacked on the popularity of White Castle's famous sliders once they burst onto the scene in the 1920s. Krystal does focus on sliders, but they've downsized and fun-sized other versions of drive-in delights too, like mini versions of chicken burgers and corn dogs that have been condensed too. The one thing Krystal should have decreased, however, was operating expenses.
Cheap food tastes good, and it's cheap.
Years of declining service and quality started to give the company a bad reputation, leading to unhappy franchisees who were seeing sales numbers dropping by an average of 10% annually. Approaching its 100th anniversary, reality settled in, and the company was forced into Chapter 11 bankruptcy in January 2020. The company has since found new ownership, bringing bright new ideas for the future of Krystal. Ideas include increasing efficiency to decrease costs by remodeling stores to use 10% less labor and 20% less cooking space, and increasing income by nearly doubling the number of Krystal locations over the next 5 years to 500 total units. By mixing new ideas into one of America's oldest establishments, Krystal's got its fingers crossed trying to avoid any more burger bankruptcies.
For bankruptcy, no thanks.
Steak and Shake.
I'm going to Steak and Shake.
Here's a long-on-the-tooth burger franchise that history might be catching up with. Steak and Shake opened its first location in the town of Normal, Illinois in 1934, and its operating style was anything but normal for the time. Owner Gus Belt was fond of being transparent with his customers, often grinding beef right in the middle of the restaurant's dining area as an illustration of the meat's lack of additives. He also had the grill line open up to the public sight of customers, a precursor to today's popular open kitchen concept where everyone gets to see how their food is handled, assembled, and cooked.
Oh, sure, they cook it, but they don't get it.
By 1954, Steak and Shake had started to move its concept of honest hamburgers out into the open, and it expanded to having locations spread across 5 states. By 1962, they opened the first franchise in Missouri and then expanded into South Texas in the 1970s. North Carolina and Wisconsin saw their first Steak and Shakes in the 1990s, and when the calendar turned to the new millennium, Oklahoma, West Virginia, and South Carolina joined the team too. But growth and expansion can sometimes lead to contraction, and the wrath soon came calling for Steak and Shake. While the company had nearly 630 nationwide eateries entering 2019, widespread closures meant they were down to just over 400 locations at the start of 2024. All told, in the half-decade span from 2018 to 2023, the company was down more than 200 total stores from coast to coast.
Everything's closed.
To turn things around, the company that was started during the Great Depression of the 1930s looked towards modernization to draw in customers. Steak and Shake has pumped some $50 million into an overhaul, including in-store remodels and point-of-purchase upgrades, transitioning to a counter-based takeout model that includes self-service kiosks. From a once-transparent restaurant, the only thing clear here is that Steak and Shake will have to put the work in to climb back to its former glory.
So shake it!
Shake it!
Shake it! Shake it!
Jack in the Box.
Yeah, was it a Jack in the Box?
The wind-up musical Jack in the Box traces its roots back to the 16th century, but the only Jack in the Box burger lovers care about is much younger. Despite its relatively short lifespan, the West Coast-based burger chain with a bobblehead mascot has never been a stranger to controversies. In 2009, the company was forced to lock up 70 locations in California for 48 hours due to owners skipping out on paying their taxes. A few years prior, in 2005, a plan for national expansion was advertised across the country for coming soon. Jack locations that, at the last minute, never materialized in several states. In the early 1990s, an E. coli outbreak landed 600 customers with food poisoning and was responsible for the deaths of four others. Back in 1981, one of Jack's overseas meat suppliers was busted stuffing non-beef meats into boxes labeled as beef, including kangaroo and horse meat.
I didn't feed you human meat.
Amid all that mayhem, however, Jack in the Box has managed to get one important part right: the food. The half-Tex, half-Mex menu that features both tacos and burgers and signature products like the Sourdough Jack have helped the company eventually reach some expansion goals, with locations across almost two dozen states. But once they reached out past the West Coast, the growth stopped moving forward, then stalled, and eventually slowly went backward. Just over 10 years ago, Jack in the Box outlets had peaked their number with 2,250 total locations, but has lost almost 70 of those spots since. The introduction of a new CEO in 2020 looked to boost things by signing on nearly 400 new franchisees and hoped to be found in 40 states by the time the calendar rolls over to 2030. It might take a few more rounds of Pop Goes the Weasel to get there, however, since we've seen that aggressive expansion booms tend to bust, and this Jack in the Box might wind up stuck at the bottom of the toy box.
Daddy will put Jack back in the box.
Sonic.
Sonic what?
Next up is a look at the struggles of Sonic, and we're not talking about the high-speed hedgehog. Long billing itself as America's drive-in, Sonic has expanded from its 1950s beginnings in Oklahoma to have a fast food footprint that spans the nation. By the middle of the 1990s, Sonic drive-ins were slinging shakes at more than 1,700 locations, and has since doubled up on that count with more than 3,500 drive-in destinations across the USA. So getting to that point means that Sonic has seen its fair share of success over the decades, but that hasn't always been the case, especially not in recent times. The descent for Sonic dates back as far as 2015 and includes a run of two straight years where the Sonic sales numbers declined in every quarterly report.
Sales are down across the board.
The company reported a revenue drop of 24% in 2017, and another 12% tumble followed that in 2018. A stroke of planet-spanning misfortune for everyone else eventually became a blessing for Sonic with the 2020 pandemic, when Sonic's drive-in model was the perfect fit for a world where curbside pickup was suddenly the norm. The company saw a 21% sales boost in the 2020 calendar year, which was worth almost $1 billion of total revenue, and has hopefully righted the ship for good after a few rough years of drive-in disasters.
I think we're back in business.
Pizza Hut.
Is Pizza Hut that great?
Here's a look at a once-giant pizza place with a few problems. A recent ad campaign featuring actor Craig Robinson constantly reminds us that no one out-pizzas the Hut. But depending on customer preference and raw sales numbers, that might not exactly be an accurate statement. First slinging slices in 1958, Pizza Hut quickly jumped to a dominant spot in the national marketplace, outpacing rivals like Domino's and Little Caesars. When the pizza race reached the 1990s, Pizza Hut was so far ahead that they had more than doubled Domino's market share to the tune of 25% to 11%. And Little Caesars had to switch ad agencies in 1998 and completely abandon a fruitless national advertising strategy. The stuffed crust company got stuffed with its own hype, however, and started to fall off, while the competition closed the gap.
Enjoy your war, pizza!
From 2008 to 2015, Little Caesars got back on track and was the nation's fastest-growing pizza chain in that span. Domino's gained traction in 2010 by announcing reworked recipes and modernizing the delivery game with state-of-the-art digital ordering and tracking techniques. Pizza Hut, meanwhile, panicked and closed hundreds of dine-in locations throughout the 2010s to shift to a takeout-based model. They flip-flopped on advertising, changing the company logo a total of four times in the two decades between 1999 and 2019, before going back to their classic look from the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Over a span of 5 years, starting in 2018, Pizza Hut closed nearly 900 locations, and they'll need to make up ground before the hut gets shut for good.
My pizza never hurt nobody.
Burger King.
You see a Burger King?
As the long-standing second-fiddle fast food favorite to McDonald's, things must be pretty good when you're at least competing for the top of the mountain. But there is recent unrest in the kingdom due to some troubling times in Whopper World. It was 2021 when Burger King finally slipped from the number two spot for overall burger sales in the USA when the up-and-coming fast food princess from Wendy's came for the crown. A nearly 5% increase in nationwide sales worth more than $10 billion to Wendy's saw them leapfrog BK, whose sales had dropped by 5.5% to a little over $9 billion for the year. A year later, in December of 2022, Wendy's also officially surpassed Burger King as our nation's most expensive major fast food chain, leaping over BK's average item cost of $5.03 by more than a buck and a half, with their average of $6.63.
Sucks for them.
The extra cost didn't deter sales, however, suggesting there may have been a permanent shift in customer perception of quality between the two restaurants. Between 2018 and 2022, BK was forced to close almost 300 stores across America, dropping from just over 7,300 locations to just over 7,000. The overall store number continues to drop, as it was down to just under 6,850 at the halfway mark of 2023. Shakespeare once wrote, "Heavy is the head that wears the crown," and the weight of BK's crown seems to be getting overwhelming.
I hurt my neck!
Papa John's.
No, not Papa John's.
Papa John's definitely aren't feeling the love. Turns out the name isn't just a marketing gimmick, and Papa John's was actually founded by Papa John Schnatter. The origins of the chain are a lovely story about a young man selling his first car to install a pizza oven in his dad's tavern. But the cuteness factor wore off when that bright-eyed young man grew up and became a nightmare for his company's public relations department. It turns out Schnatter doesn't only open his mouth to put pizza in it, he also does so to get himself in trouble.
Up next is Papa John dyeing his eyebrows.
Instead of sticking to pizza, Mr. Schnatter chimed in on the 2017 National Football League national anthem controversy and kicked up enough of a stir that he stepped down as Papa John's CEO to save face for the brand. 1 year later, in the summer of 2018, Schnatter used a racial slur on a company conference call and was summarily dismissed from his corporate chairman position. A legal battle between the actual Papa John and the company which bore his name then carried on into the following year, eventually settling in a compromise that allowed Schnatter to keep his job and ownership if he dropped two wrongful dismissal lawsuits. The publicly strained relationship continues to make the company's image messier than mopping up a plate of Papa John's famous garlic sauce, which in turn affects sales.
Bring the company down.
Chick-fil-A.
Watch your back, Chick-fil-A.
Only selling products to hungry customers 6 days a week might be the least of the worries at Chick-fil-A. Despite not being open on Sundays, on the days they're actually open, the company takes a lazy Sunday pace to its business practices. Industry surveys show Chick-fil-A has the worst wait times of the top 10 fast food chains in the country, 3.5 minutes longer than the competition at KFC, with an average 8-minute-plus wait at the Chick-fil-A counter. And wait times aren't the only thing on the rise.
That price is sky high!
While we've already seen Burger King and Wendy's duking it out for officially having the country's highest fast food prices, Chick-fil-A's average prices jumped 15.5% as recently as 2022, putting them at an average of $4.65, and just behind Wendy's average of $6.63. However, the extra charge of cash for your chicken isn't the only issue plaguing Chick-fil-A's public perception. The company's corporate side has long-running issues of civil rights violations. They clash at the United States federal government level in 2019, the municipal government level in San Francisco, Chicago, and Boston throughout 2012, and the state government level in Texas in 2019. So whether it's a matter of cost, conscience, or just being time-consuming, there's no shortage of reasons to go clucking to the competition to get your chicken fix.
If nobody eats my chicken, I'm gonna kill myself.
Baskin Robbins.
That used to be a Baskin Robbins.
business hasn't been hot for the cool folks at Baskin Robbins either. Expanding from its roots of a humble ice cream parlor founded in 1945, Baskin Robbins had nearly 8,000 locations around the world by 2019. But while too many flavors is never a problem, we now know that too much expansion certainly can be. Baskin Robbins brought their 31 flavors to the African continent at the end of 2016, but the cost of shipping supplies across the world made for high prices and low sales. And after just 3 years, Baskin Robbins shut the freezer for good and closed their African locations. Things didn't melt quite as fast with expansion into the Philippines in 2014, but the sudden and unexpected closure of every Philippines location in December of 2022 meant BR had dropped its metaphorical ice cream cone there, too.
You said we were going to Baskin Robbins!
Despite international issues raising alarm bells, there are still more than 2,400 Baskin Robbins locations in its home country of America. To prevent having to close any of those down, though, the company decided to make a proactive move in spring 2022 and get ahead of any misfortunes at home that had haunted them overseas. Baskin Robbins has rebranded its image entirely from top to bottom with a reworked logo, a catchy new Seize the Yay slogan, and an across-the-board revamp of food packaging and employee uniforms for a fresh look for the frozen faves. Hopefully, it'll keep them out of the heat and in the cool for many more years to come.
And have enough milk left over to open up Baskin Robbins.
Stick around, leave us a comment, and check out another great video.